Hello, I'm Joan Temkin from the League of Women Voters of Amherst, and the Northampton Area League has asked me to be your moderator tonight. Can you hear me now? He's working on it. Okay. I can hear me now. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization. It encourages the informed and active participation of citizens in government, works to increase understanding of major policy issues, and influences public policy through education and advocacy. Before we begin, I want to thank our sponsors, the League of Women Voters of the Northampton Area, the Daily Hampshire Gazette, the Northampton Community TV, WHMP, the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association, and the Leeds Civic Association. Thank you. We are broadcasting live on NCTV and WHMP, and we do request that you turn off your cell phones. Yes, we all need that reminder. Our format for tonight is to have two panels. First, the candidates for school committee, who are seated to my left, and then the candidates for the city council. The candidates are seated alphabetically, and we've drawn straws to choose the first speaker on each panel. Candidates will have 2 minutes for opening statements. I will follow with questions that have been selected from those that were submitted through several websites, and each candidate will have 90 seconds to respond. There will be time for a couple of questions from the audience here at the end of each panel, and candidates will have 60 seconds to respond to those questions. We will have closing statements of 1 minute each. Then we'll have a brief hiatus to switch panels, and the same format will apply. Should a candidate directly criticize or single out another candidate, that candidate will have 30 seconds to rebut, but candidates may only have one rebuttal each. We hope there'll be no need for rebuttals. We know that the level of discourse will be civil and respectful. There are cards available to you to write your questions. I see them here and I see pencils, so I'm not sure if those are going to get passed out. People have cards? Great. So if you don't get to ask your question here, and what we'll do at the end is you'll come up here to the mic and line up if you're going to have, if you want to ask a question here. But if you don't get to ask your question, then there will be time after to talk with the candidates, and we'll also collect your questions and pass them along to NCTV and WHMP, and they can follow up then when they interview the candidates. In the front row, we have Penny Geis, who is our timer. She's seated right there, and we'll hold up cards indicating how much time is left. Okay, we'll begin. To my left, we have three of the four candidates running for school committee. They're running for the two at-large seats. They are Molly Burnham, Blue Duval, who is an incumbent, and Nat Reed, and Carrie Nykerchuk declined to attend tonight's forum. So we'll begin with our opening statements, and Mr. Reed, you won the straw. So okay. You may begin with your two-minute opening statement.
Can you hear me? Great, okay. So I'm Nat Reed, and I am running for school committee because this may sound a little corny, but I just really love Northampton. And this is the greatest place I've ever lived, and I feel like I want it to have great schools as well. I have two sons who both started at kindergarten at Bridge Street School. One is now loving the band right here at JFK. The other is loving his history classes at the high school. I've mostly worked as a writer, but I grew up in a family of teachers, so I've always been very involved in education. I've taught filmmaking and drama to children. I've taught writing and editing to adults. I've taught environmental education on a boat in New York Harbor. And right now, my wife and I have a communications business that has allowed us to go into some of the most improved schools in Massachusetts, elementary schools, And that's been a real eye-opening experience for me. These schools are mostly lower income and more challenged than Northampton, but I went into classrooms where I saw things that made me say, wow, this is amazing. I really want this for Northampton. So that has really informed what I would like to do on the school committee. I would really like to work on ensuring that we're developing the best possible classroom methods so that all students get the help they need, but also the challenge that, students really enjoy. To do that, we need to really step up our professional development, make sure that it's research-backed training for teachers and for principals. And to do that, we need an active school committee that is really setting goals and working to listen to the community. So I think I'll bring three things to the school committee that are of value. One is my educational experience. The other is that I have experience with proven methods that work, and my communication skills that I hope will involve all of you in our school decision. So thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Reed. Ms. Burnham, if you'll go next, please.
Great. And can everybody hear me? Okay, is that too loud? So hi, I'm Molly Burnham. I'm also running for school committee at large. I've lived in the Valley since 2001 when my husband and I moved out here for him to go to University of Massachusetts. Our kids have been born here and are growing up here. Our kids have gone to the public school as well since kindergarten. We have a fourth grader now at Jackson Street School, and we have a daughter who's in seventh grade at JFK. And they both love everything that they do, except for the occasional meltdown of, you know, homework. I taught at Jackson Street School for just over 5 years. I started as an ESP there, although I already had my master's in elementary education. And I moved into a teaching position. I taught kindergarten and third grade. I stopped that and went back to school to go for an MFA in writing for children and young adults. And I worked with Barbara Black in the early childhood offices at Bridge Street School. I write full-time now as a children's writer. And I've also been on the Jackson Street School Council for many years. I want to run for school committee because I really love this city, but actually more than that, I really love public education. I really love our kids. I'm an advocate for children, and I'm an advocate for public education. I love our schools, which doesn't mean that we can't always make them better, which is life. It's like a garden. We can always make our garden better. And I think that there's really exciting ways that we can do that if we come together, if we bring the community, children too, teachers, school committee, administrators, parents, and work together to in a non-judgmental and wonderfully passionate, open discussion, like a wonderful classroom, like the wonderful classrooms that we do have in Northampton.
Thank you. Ms. Duval.
Good evening, and thank you all for coming. My name is Blue Duval, and I am seeking my third term of re-election as the school committee member at large. The school committee has three responsibilities. They are to hire the superintendent, to set a hopefully fiscally responsible, viable budget, and we set school policies. Right now, our school committee is made up of two-thirds of it is teachers and attorneys. I also think a balance is important to have representing. I am an active member and a visible presence at all six of Northampton schools. I attend throughout the years, different events. I go to all the different open houses. And for the first couple of years, I was the only school committee member out there doing that. I'm so grateful to Ann Hennessy and Laura Fallon now. They're also active members of our board. And I believe that Northampton Public Schools deserve more members, more school committee members who are active, who reach out, who take it more than just a Thursday night come and do make decisions, but actually make conscientious decisions based on knowledge, based on talking to people, based on research. I have served on many committees, including the Rules and Policy Committee, the Conference Committee, the Northampton Prevention Coalition. I am a legislative liaison and a special education parent advisory board. I have also been on volunteer committees, such as the Physical Education and the Late Start Ad Hoc Committee, the Principal Search Committees at Ryan Road and Northampton, and I participated in the search committee at Leeds. Recently, we had a district improvement plan. It was open to anybody in the entire community. I was a participant in that, and anyone on the board or anyone of you could have also been a member of that. It was nice to see, like I said, two other members there, and I would hope that whomever we have sitting up here next to me believes in being involved in reaching out to the community in a tangible way in our schools. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll move on now to our first question, and this one will go first to Ms. Burnham, then Ms. Duval, and then Mr. Reed. For a school committee to be successful, decisions must be made. How do you see your role on the school committee, and what skills do you bring that will help balance your personal biases, your advocacy for the constituencies you represent, and the need for balanced governance? Do you have any conflicts of interest to disclose? And Ms. Burnham, we'll begin with you.
Thank you. This is a question of many pieces, I am going to say. I don't have any conflicts of interest to disclose. I'm going to start with the easy one first. I was a teacher. I have a lot of connections with the different schools and with the community of schools. I think that my teaching practice was really rooted in early childhood approach, a very child-centered and very hands-on approach. So I think that everything I do actually comes from that place also. So working on a school committee should be that that we have dialogue and that we are engaged in a practice. Gosh, this goes quickly. I'm an educator. That is the skill that I bring. But I'm a great listener, and I can set aside my values for the greater good of everybody.
Great, thank you. Ms. Duval.
Thank you. For a school committee to be successful, decisions must be made. That's true. And those decisions are not easy decisions, but hopefully they're well-informed decisions. My role on the school committee has been to ask questions, has been to contact people, find out what the issues are, find out if there's research backing whatever the issue is at the time, and going from there. I was raised in the Northampton schools. I graduated, I brought my kids back. They are also in the Northampton schools. And I don't have any conflicts of interest to disclose. I just am trying to be there for everybody and all students, parents, whomever needs that help.
Thank you. And Mr. Reed,
I also have no conflicts of interest. So role of the school committee is, if you look at the State Board of Ed, says it should be the board of directors for our school system, and the superintendent should be like the CEO. The state statute also talks about how it's the role of the school committee to set goals, and I think that's something that our school committee needs to really start to do. We need to really, as a group, and I emphasize group because it's not one person, it's 10 people, we need to set some real goals and work towards it. And the other thing that I think the school committee role needs to be is to be a conduit for all of you. We are elected by you, we need to listen to you. That's not something that's always happened, and I would like to really work on that. Thanks.
Thank you. We'll move on to our next question, and this one will start with Ms. Duval, go to Mr. Reed, and then Ms. Burnham. As an at-large candidate, do you think you have a good handle on the concerns of the entire district? Which schools are you most familiar with, And how will you reach out to parents in other districts? Ms. DeVall.
Okay. I believe that I have a very good handle on the concerns of the entire district. That's because people write me, and I am out there, and I am visible. As far as the different schools that I attend, I have attended each and every open house for the past 4 years, except the smattering if I was ill or an overlap. But that's been a priority for me. It's a priority for me to be in the schools and to get my information and to have my ear to the ground and to listen to people. How would I reach out to parents in other districts? If they want me, I'm available. I would reach out by being available. So, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Reed?
Hi. Concerns in the entire district. Well, I have, my kids have been through 3 of the 6 buildings, and I've made an effort to connect with people in the other buildings, and that's something that I would try very hard to continue to do. I'd love to go to school council and PTO meetings. Parents, whether I do communications, so communicating with all of you and responding to your concerns and bringing them to the school committee is something that I'm very comfortable with, and I think it's an area for improvement that I can help with.
Thank you. Our next question.
Wait, me.
Oh.
Me.
Oh. feel free to jump in. Yes, Ms. Burnham. I'm sorry.
I think I do have a good handle on the concerns. I've been on the Jackson Street School Council for many years, and I am involved and I talk to a lot of people all the time about our schools because I love talking about education. If anybody knows me, that is what I talk about. And I don't know the high school, I admit that, and I'm so excited to learn about it. But since deciding to run, I got over to Ryan Road, and I look forward to interacting more with Leeds. And I think it's just about outreach. We need to be making contact with people.
Thank you. I believe all 3 of you have now answered that question. Great. Moving right along. And this one will begin with Mr. Reed, then Ms. Burnham, and then Ms. DeVall. How does state and federal testing, Common Core, and ranking affect our public schools? How should the data from these sources be used? And should it be used to prioritize the distribution of resources to individual schools within the district? Mr. Reed.
That is a 10-20-hour discussion that I have, 60 seconds for, and I've just wasted 15 of them. But
you have 90, so.
Okay. Common Core is a big problem. People talk a lot about, actually, I shouldn't say that Common Core is a big problem. It's something that exists. The state has voted for it. It is what it is. And frankly, that's not what my biggest focus would be on. Improving the way we're teaching in the classroom, the way we're training teachers. There's definitely data in all of this testing that can be used diagnostically. I think high-stakes testing is a real problem that we ought to push back against. I don't think data should be used to punish teachers or districts. It should be used diagnostically. We should use the information from tests to figure out where we need to help people rather than punish them. And the state has got it exactly backwards, in my opinion. So. We could have a much longer discussion at another time.
Thank you. Ms. Burnham, and we are doing 90 seconds, yes?
We were.
Okay.
Okay.
Those were the quickest 90 seconds for the first couple.
This is the best debate I've ever been in. Okay. forum. How do I feel about the MCAS? I feel that the MCAS is an unfunded mandate that drives us all crazy. I feel like we are at odds with it all the time. I think that we say as a population that we don't value it, and then one of our schools is given level 3, And suddenly, we're in arms that that school is level three and that that means something. I think we want to go right to our teachers. They are doing assessments all the time. They do amazing assessments. And actually, the superintendent, I know, has brought in some new systems as well. And we need to look and we need to value everything that the teachers know and give them time to process what they know so that they can implement it in the classrooms and to have that be a conversation with the MCAS data. The MCAS data is coming from the state, and you know, again, we need to separate, or I need to separate, my values about what I feel about the MCAS and also the reality of the situation. And those are two different things. I can fight MCAS as a high-stakes testing, which I can do on my personal time. As a school representative, as in school committee, I need to know that it's there, and I need to push for us to give power to the teachers who know our children.
Thank you. Ms. Duval.
Common Core is complicated because we need some form of standards with which to graduate. However, not all children are the same. So we need to make sure that we take that into consideration, that when we implement the Common Core, if we choose to ultimately implement the Common Core, that we understand that not all kids are destined to go to college and may not have those same needs. I believe so much to say on this one. It's hard to just kind of narrow it down. Should the data from these sources be used to prioritize the distribution of resources to individual schools within the districts? Definitely. If we have schools that are weaker or less or have needs, then we need to take and focus our energy and our dollars on that, on those schools. We've been doing that as a school committee already, and we will continue to do that. I agree with Ms. Burnham. We need to value the teachers' inputs. We need to value the classroom experience. Unfunded mandates make it difficult for all of us to decide the directions of the school because we don't have the finances available because it's being spent elsewhere. I urge all of you to talk to your legislators and try to get more money into our schools because we're working the best that we can with the budget that we currently have. Thank you.
Thank you. You're all doing extremely well. These are difficult questions and a short amount of time, so thank you. Yes, we'll stay within 90 seconds, yeah. 90 minutes could be kind of fun, but that's a different meeting. Our next question, and this one will go first to Ms. Burnham, then Ms. Duval, and Mr. Reed. Northampton is in a losing financial competition whenever a Northampton student chooses to go to a charter school. We can offset some of that cost by having children from other towns come to Northampton through participation in the school choice program. But that financially impacts our neighbor schools. If Governor Baker lifts the charter school cap, this could exacerbate the problem. Does the school committee have a role to play in this debate? Ms. Burnham.
Our job is to do the best that we can for our students. Best practice, best practice, best practice. If we do that, I really feel that we won't have to compete with this charter school. I actually don't want to compete with the charter schools. That again is another separation. On school committee, what we need to focus on is our schools and making them and showing how they are right now such wonderful, dynamic, beautiful learning environments They are extraordinary, and I am moved every time I go into a classroom. I am amazed that these community of kids come together. And I have to say, I particularly see it at JFK, the last 3 years before they go either to the high school or to the vocational school. It's an outstanding thing that we should honor and love, and we don't need to think. I know that charter schools are a financial drain. That's a government, a big government, and also the city, the mayor is trying to find ways to bring more money in. What we need to do is simply think about what we do in our schools, have discussions about best practice, how to support the teachers with that, with wonderful professional development, and we will do great.
Thank you. I just have a quick question. Would you like me to repeat the question each time, or are you fine just following?
We have our little team.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, Ms. Duval, you're next.
Okay. I agree that Northampton is in a losing financial competition whenever a Northampton student chooses to go to a charter school. However, right now, children from other districts have capped our the number of kids that can come into our charter schools. I mean, into our schools, not our charter schools, into our public schools. Through school choice. There are many more that would like to come and simply can't come. I believe that we should look at why do those kids want to come here? What is it that we're offering that's so wonderful? And then turn around and take that data and sell it to the kids that are already here. Charter schools take resources, and very valuable resources, from our public schools. Public school education is an education for all and equity for all. Charter schools don't have the same rules and regulations with which we have to abide. The superintendent went through his district findings and created a district improvement plan. A lot of those issues are addressed in that plan, and we have a direction for the next 5 years so that we can, as one of them, look at why so many kids are still leaving our schools. We need to get those kids back, or at least show them that we do have the best. We have wonderful teachers, we have wonderful schools, and we have a wonderful community. And I just like to support our public schools.
Thank you. Mr. Reed.
So, charter schools. The first thing I want to say about this is that I think there is no value in shaming or blaming the parents who choose to send their kids to charter schools. And I'm not saying anybody here has done that, but that's been in our culture for a while. And I just don't think it's productive. And I think that those parents are doing what that parents are supposed to do, which is they are advocating for their children and what they think is best for their children. On the other hand, charter schools are a huge financial drain. I think last year it was $1.2 million that came out of our budget that went to charter schools. And so what are we going to do about that? First of all, Charlie Baker is completely wrong about raising the cap on charter schools. We should absolutely keep that cap in place. And we need to lobby Boston to change the funding formula. I believe even Stanley Rosenberg is open to the idea of taking the funding and making it a line item, which would definitely help us. But I also think that we are in a marketplace or a competition with the charter schools, whether we like it or not, and that we need to bolster our schools so that they're more appealing than the charter schools. And I don't think that that's a very difficult task. Because there's so much amazing good stuff that we already have here. We already have the ingredients for an amazing school. You know, we have experienced teachers. Charter schools, not always. We have these great diverse populations. We have this building, we're about to have robotics. I mean, what charter school parent wouldn't want that? So I think we can compete and we can win.
Thank you. Our next question, and this will be first Ms. Duval, then Mr. Reed, then Ms. Burnham. How do you rate Northampton schools? What do you see as their strengths, and where does attention need to be focused? Ms. Duval?
I think we have wonderful schools. We insist on rigor, and we have, and we have it throughout our schools. What we're working on right now is having a both a horizontal and a vertical alignment of our priorities and our philosophies. What do you see as the strengths? The strengths, we have a very strong ELL program. We have wonderfully strong teachers. We have dedicated teachers who stay after school way beyond when they're asked to help students if necessary. Where does attention need to be focused? I would like to see language in our elementary schools. If we could get money, I think the language, we should pay for language in our elementary schools at the very beginning level. I think it would do a few things. It would help kids with language, and that would help with the Common Core ultimately, but also it would show everyone that we have value and we value diversity. Language best is learned when they're young, as opposed to in sixth and seventh grade. And it's incredible to me, though, that the work that the teachers are doing in those grades and how those kids are still learning. But if we were to do things like implement language in the early grades, then we would show everyone that we value all cultures. And my time, okay, sorry. So I also think that we need to focus on data so that we know where we are and where we're going, and make sure that we stay in alignment with our philosophies.
Thank you. Mr. Reed?
So, I mean, if you want to know how the schools are rated, you can look at the state. There's a lot of rating there. You can question the MCAS or not. I'm not going to go there. I think we do have incredible strengths in this district. I feel as though there are lots of the ingredients for a level one district. We're level three, but I think we have the ingredients for a level one district if we just sort of cook them a little bit better. If we kind of do a lot of little things better, like the way we train our teachers, the way we develop techniques in the classroom, the way we work together in buildings and between buildings. And so that's where I think we need to work on things. I mean, the superintendent a week ago came to this room and said that reading levels are below the state average in all four buildings. That breaks my heart. I mean, that means that we have kids who are struggling to learn to read, and we're not addressing their problems. That is horrible, because kids who don't get their reading problems addressed quickly, they fall through the cracks. They end up on the sped track. They end up dropping out. The statistics are really clear on this. So we have so many great assets, but we really need to set some goals at the school committee level, and really start working on those and really taking a good system and making it great.
Thank you. Ms. Burnham.
I love our schools. Almost everybody that I talk to has amazing stories to tell. We all have moments of difficulty in our schools. We all have moments of difficulty in life. We all have moments of difficulty as being parents. And I, again, feel, though, that all of that goes into the wonderfulness of the fabric of public school, of what public education is. I really don't actually like to look at what level we are on. I don't glean any information from that. The strengths that I see in our schools, I know that in the elementary schools that we use the absolutely best curriculum. We use Teachers College reading and writing program, and we use Investigations for our math curriculum. I know that teams of teachers thought very hard about what math curriculum to use at JFK, and I think one of the greatest challenges of our time is not trusting teachers for some reason, but I actually trust the teachers, and I trust that they have thought about the complexity of the issues, just like I trust the teachers in the elementary schools, that they thought about all of this, and I worked with them on some of it, so I know the passion that went into it. I always go back to professional development because I think being a teacher is one of the most exhausting and difficult jobs in the entire world. And we need to support their energy and their work through that.
Thank you. This is the last question that we have selected. So if those of you who are going to be wanting to line up at the mic as we end this question, if you would go ahead and do that. And this one will begin with Mr. Reed, then Ms. Burnham, then Ms. DeVoe. What programs, if any, should the school system initiate or augment should funds become available?
Well, that's a nice problem to have, and I hope that we do have it, and that brings up the subject of funding, which is really problematic. And I want to thank everybody who supported the overrides because they have been so crucial to saving basic things in this school. We've had cuts in our budget for, I think, 8 of 9 years or 9 of 10 years, and it's really bare bones. I know a teacher who started working here, and he took $11,000 a year pay cut to work here. I mean, high schools with classes with 30 plus in them, we really have funding problems. So if the Lord willing and the pilot program comes through and the Raise Up Massachusetts program comes through and we actually have more money to spend, I don't think it's a matter of adding programs. I think it's a matter of doing the things that we're already doing better. I think that our teachers have been shortchanged, frankly, for quite a few years. They're paid less than area districts. I think that's a place that we have to look at. There and then again, the things that I've been talking about, professional development for teachers and for principals, so that we are really stepping up the types of classroom instruction that we're offering. And I'm out of time.
Okay. Ms. Burnham.
Thank you.
Sorry.
If we had more money, I would have way more art. We all need more art. We all need more music. At JFK, there are kids that have scheduling conflicts, and so they cannot choose to take band or chorus. And that's a huge, that's awful. They should get to. Languages, of course. It would be amazing if they started earlier. And we used to have band programs in the elementary schools. Of course, we used to have vice principals in the elementary schools, and we had more guidance counselors as well. I am very passionate about how inequity affects kids and their learning. And I think that if we had more money in our district, if we could spend more time working with families that have challenges, usually it's financial challenges that do a lot of stop a lot of stuff in our culture, as we know. And it would be amazing to see and to be able to support a lot of outreach, which is actually happening. There's an amazing second language teacher at Ryan Road who's doing incredible outreach, and you can see what that does for the families who are challenged in our communities.
Thank you. Ms. DeVoe.
Well, I believe that if the school committee comes into a lot of money, that we should look at what our schools were before Proposition 2.5 and go to town. We could bring back language arts, which has been taken, language, French in elementary schools. We no longer have that. We no longer have music in the elementary schools. I would like to see arts at all levels. I would also say if we had more money, I would want there to be a late bus. I think that a late bus would change the culture of the high school. It would allow a lot of kids at the high school to stay after, talk to teachers, to hang out with friends, to take time in the library, to join clubs. I think that there's a problem with equity, and when we don't offer a late bus, we're feeding into that inequity, that inequitable situation, because some kids need that ride home. I think we should really focus on creating an environment that's fair for all. Another thing is the district improvement plan that that I'm a part of, one of our goals is to provide a balance to all the schools based on equity and based on early education. We need to get to students the very beginning, identify the issues, don't let anybody fall between the cracks, because if you're a parent and it's only 1% falling between the cracks, and that happens to be your child, that's 100% of your reality, and we can't afford that. Thank you.
Thank you. I do see we have some people lined up, and I think we'll have time. I know we'll have time for two questions, and we'll see how it goes. Yeah, you'll have to come all the way up so that you can be seen on television. And if you please would identify yourself. Okay, so the rules will be if you'd identify yourself. We're trying to get this mic working.
Check 1, 2.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So if you would identify yourself, and the questions must be addressed to all of the candidates so they all have a chance to answer. Please.
Hi. My name is Julie Spencer Robinson. I'm the president of the Northampton Association of School Employees, a teacher here at JFK, and a parent of a student also here at JFK. When the superintendent presented his entry findings, one of the issues that he identified was high teacher and staff turnover in the district. And I wonder how you might address that challenge if you were to serve on the school committee.
Does everyone understand the question? Okay. We will begin with Ms. Burnham, then Ms. Duvall, and Mr. Reed. And you have 60 seconds on this one.
That's a great question. I think that we've had high turnover with our superintendents as well. And I'm hopeful that we are going to have somebody who stays. And I think having that person who stays in that position, who has a strong moral sense and a clear vision and works collaboratively with the school committee, will inspire people to stay. And I think that if our focus is really valuing the teachers and having an open dialogue where we can discuss the challenges of being teachers as well as the wonderfulness of being a teacher, and we can supply the excellent curriculum and support through professional development. I know I keep saying that, but it's so important to teachers to collaborate and to be together. I think that we will keep staff. I know that some of the challenges are the amount of money that people make here, but actually people want to teach in our district because it is a beautiful, vast array of people and so much fun.
Thank you. Ms. Duvall.
What was the question again? Just the basic overview of what? How do we approach staff turnover? Well, I think that we need to work on respect. We need to let teachers know that we respect and support them. A way to do that is when we're looking at curriculums that are going to be implemented, I believe we should ask the teachers, what do you think? How do you feel about the new program? Do you have something better? The teachers are on the front line, and the teachers know what's happening in the schools. They also know what it is that they need to be successful and to feel successful. In life, we can't always get the amount of money that we want, and unfortunately, since Proposition 2.5, we have issues with being able to pay people the amount of money that they deserve. However, sometimes it's not just about money. It's about a good, positive, supportive working environment. I want our teachers to know that we support them and that we care about their opinions, and I think that especially with this last fundamentals program that was just implemented, I think that it brought to light that we need to ask our teachers more what they think and how they see what's happening in our schools, and ask them right out, what would it take to keep you here? Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Reed.
I agree. I think we need to involve stakeholders. That's basic. And nobody knows better than teachers why teachers are not retained. And we should poll them. We should ask them. And I'd be really curious to know what the reasons are. I mean, I definitely hear teachers talk about the fact that they could make more money in every other district surrounding here. I hear them talk about state mandates that are just oppressive. I mean, evaluation processes that they have to go through. That one friend of mine who's a teacher said, if my principal went through what the state is requiring me to do in terms of evaluations, that's all my principal would do all year long, is the state process. So I don't know. It might be finding things that take up a lot of time and don't have a lot of impact on the classroom that we could somehow push aside. I mean, we have a great resource in our full-time union person, so I think we should use that person.
Thank you. We'll take another question from the audience.
Hi, I'm Erin Mahan Moore. I'm from Leeds. I'm a parent on the Leeds School Council and a member of the Northampton Public Schools Action Coalition. My question is, where is the data that Northampton Public Schools collects through assessments such as AIMSWeb and on grading platforms such as Aspen stored? Who has access to this data? And is protection of sensitive student data such as IEPs and 504s a priority for you, especially as some of the provisions of FERPA have been of this stored information becomes a very potential.
Ooh, that's a long question. Before you sit down, let's make sure. Do you all understand the question? Do you want to hear it again?
I'd like to hear it again. I mean, just okay. The gist. I yeah. Get it, but.
The gist is, where is all of the data that the Northampton Public Schools collects stored? Who has access to this data within district or state or national? And is protection of sensitive student data, such as 504s and IEPs, a priority for you, especially as some of the provisions of FERPA have been eroded and exposure of this stored information becomes a very potential reality?
Privacy is of our students is of utmost importance, and it's also the law. We're not allowed to identify students, and so I'm not sure exactly where they keep the data. Maybe a data bank down in, but I know that Lori Farkas has the IEPs and the special education programs, and that she's the holder of that key. I know that the superintendent, John Provost, he also has quite a bit of the data that he also protects that isn't able to get out and be brought out. The data that is in the district improvement plan, and it's a basis of how we decided upon the district improvement plan and the goals that we're going toward. But yeah, it is important to protect all students' privacy. I'm hoping I answered the question that you're asking, but that's ultimately it. And we do take that very, very seriously. Okay. Very seriously.
Thank you. Mr. Reed?
Just my immediate reaction is this is why we need a responsive school committee and why we need dialogue with the community. And that is what the school committee is supposed to be in the statute. We are supposed to be the people that listen to you and bring your concerns to the superintendent. So this is an example of how involving the community makes us all smarter. I mean, I don't know where you are, Erin, but you brought up a point that's really important that I would not have thought of, and I really appreciate you doing that. And I hope that you'll be encouraged to continue to bring questions like that forward. I don't have an answer for you. It's the kind of thing where if I was on the school committee, I would find you an answer. And it reminds me of a conversation I had with a parent who is also concerned about Google. That we get this stuff from Google and we use Google, but there's very little security there. And he's opting for whether we can use shareware, that's not the right term, open source software to do the same things, possibly with less cost. So it's a great question. I'm glad you brought it up.
Thank you. Ms. Burnham.
I think that I agree with everything that these other wonderful people have said. Privacy is essential to our children. And I would, as a school committee, I mean, what I could say, Erin, is that as a school committee member, exactly, if you brought that question to me, I would probably also think about going to our technology person and talking to him about it. Nat also brought up this, a similar concern that a similar parent had brought to me as well about our use of Google and how much information Google can glean about our students through it. And it's something that's been circling my mind a lot since it was brought up. So I think in this case, I don't have an answer, but I am a child of an investigative reporter, and I love doing stuff like this. So I would go and take it and investigate. It's a great news story, and I also hope that if the Gazette is here, they think about covering it.
Thank you. I know we have more people lined up, but we're running out of time for this segment. So I'm going to encourage you to write your questions down and hold them and talk to the candidates after. I apologize that we can't take them all. So we're going to move on to our closing statements. You're almost released. We'll begin with Ms. Duvall.
How long do we have on this?
Oh, I'm sorry. 1 minute.
Okay, great. I've served on the Northampton School Committee for the past 4 years, two terms, and I've enjoyed it very much. I've talked with many people, I've delved into many issues, and I attend all the different schools and as many events as possible because all of the different schools have a different community feeling to them. That being said, regardless of that community feeling, we also need to look at the fact that we need horizontal alignment of our elementary schools. I think that's something that we should work on. That also happens to be in the district improvement plan. A lot of the questions that are being raised are being answered through the district improvement plan. Anyone in the whole city could have been on the district improvement plan and could have been responsible for the direction our schools are going to be going within the next 5 years. Myself, Ann Hennessy, and Laura Fallon were the only school committee members that took that opportunity to be part of a very exciting future. I would encourage everyone to look at the district improvement plan to see where we're going, to see how it's addressing equity, horizontal and vertical alignment, and just the wonderful things and the direction that our schools are going to be having within the next few years, the next 5 years. So thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Reed?
Hi. So I want to, first of all, thank all the organizers for putting this together, and I want to thank all of you who came out here tonight to show your concern and your support and your interest in public education, because I just want to get on the soapbox a little bit here. Public education is incredibly important, and it's under threat, and I just don't think that I want to live in a country where a great education is only accessible to the people who are either very lucky or very wealthy. And this public school system of ours is where we prevent that from happening. You know, our schools don't just teach our kids about algebra and Ernest Hemingway. I mean, I'm thinking about a child who sat next to one of my children in class who is from another country. His parents are very low literacy and very low education, and it's our public schools are this boy's only path to a successful and secure life. So when we support these public schools, we're not just teaching people stuff. We're preserving these values that we think are really important. We're preserving fairness in this country. We're even preserving our own economy, because educated workers are what makes this country strong. So I want to thank all of you for supporting public education, and I hope you'll continue to do so.
Thank you. And Ms. Burnham.
Thanks. I really do thank you all for coming out. It's really exciting. And one of the really great things about running for school committee at large is that it's has given me the chance to come into little pockets of Northampton and meet people and listen to their concerns and their wonderful stories as well. I feel so excited to whatever happens in this election to go forward with this energy. We have a wealth of people. Our schools have a history, they have a present, and they have a future. And there are people in this room and people in this city who know the history really well and can tell stories about things that have changed, about why we changed them, about what was great, what went away, what was good that we got rid of. And we have a present that we can learn from, and we have a future that we can develop. And I think that the school committee just has a great opportunity to do that.
Thank you. Well, I think you can all see you have a very tough choice in this coming election. These are wonderful candidates. Thank you so much. Let's give them all a big hand.
Thank you.
So we can all relax for a minute while we change panels. Thank you. So we've switched our panels, and now we have, can you all hear me? Yes. We've switched our panels, and now we have the candidates for city council seated up here. And they are Jesse Adams, who is an incumbent, Bill Dwight, an incumbent, and Mark Warner. So I'm just going to briefly remind you of our format. You'll have 2 minutes for opening statements, 90 seconds for answers to the six questions I'll be posing, 60 seconds for answers, and I think we saw in the last panel that we probably can get through two questions, and that'll be it. And then you'll have 60 seconds for your closing statements. You also have the 30 seconds for rebuttal if you need to use that. So we will begin, and Mr. Warner, you have the privilege of the first 2 minute opening statement.
Okay, thanks. In the last 6 years, Northampton has had 3 tax overrides, a 40% increase in water rates, a 42% increase in sewer rates, 50% increase in solid waste fees, hotel motel tax gone up 50%, added 3% Community Preservation Act fee, a $2 million stormwater fee added, and a new tax on restaurant meals. And now the city is hoping that Smith College and a dozen other tax-exempt organizations will voluntarily live up to the big city payments in lieu of taxes. I don't think these asks are easy, and I don't think they were necessarily wrong. But the key point is that our city budget is chronically above the limits placed by Proposition 2.5, and it's also been above the inflation rate for cities and the state governments. Moreover, our expenses aren't going down. We have a $50 million long-term obligations for pension and retiree health program. This is going to be growing to maybe $100 million in the next decade, $100 million in stormwater and flood control needs, 10 years worth of backlog on roads, and we still have to deal with growing costs to maintain the quality of our schools and other public services. I don't believe that our citizens will or should continue to accept routine tax limit overrides, but we're running out of other revenue tricks, and the challenge will shift to meeting core public services efficiently. These are the real challenges that the city faces. The mayor, of course, has a big role in this, but so does the council. I know they do because I helped write the city charter that helped put that gave those powers to them. And now I'm asking for a seat at the council table itself. I do so with a commitment to take on these challenges with integrity, with fairness, with courage, and with a good sense about the impacts on all of Northampton. Am I up for the challenges? Well, here's one thing. I'm taking on the challenge of running against 2 well-respected and known city councilors here. So I'm delighted to be in this race, and I hope that my flyer, my website, and my performance at debate tonight will assure you that I am the sensible candidate.
Thank you. Mr. Adams, if you would go next.
Hi, my name is Jesse Adams. I'm a Northampton City Councilor at Large, and I'm running for re-election, and I'd like your support. I am an attorney with a law practice on Main Street and have been practicing there for 8 years. After having lived downtown on Main Street for 15 years and then downtown Florence for 2 years. In July of this year, I bought a home in Leeds with my wife, Emily. We were married on October 10th, like 11 days ago. If I seem distracted, it's because I'm distracted by my wife's beauty. But she didn't pick out my outfit. I have a passion for public service, and I'm proud of my accomplishments as well as what I have stood for in my 8 years in public office. I believe in good, effective city services, fairness, accountability, and affordability. I want our city to be home to all people who choose to live here. I want government to be fair and accessible. These are things that matter to me. I work towards these things daily as a city councilor. As an attorney, I fight daily for fairness, justice, and the constitutional rights of those who have been marginalized, ignored, and underserved in our society. I fight for equal treatment of people, both as an attorney and as a city councilor. In my 6 years on the city council, I have worked very hard to make our community a better place for all those who live here and visit. One accomplishment of which I am proud is having written the plastic bag ban ordinance, which passed unanimously and will take effect next year. This city law will further our commitment to sustainability and environmental protection. If reelected, I will continue to fight for environmental justice, fairness, accessibility, and accountability in city government and a community in which we can all afford to live. Please vote for me Tuesday, November 3rd.
Thank you. And Mr. Dwight?
First, I want to acknowledge the mouse that's in here, just so that there is a mouse. Everyone's trying to be very polite and not acknowledging it. So if it does come by, you're welcome to scream, and I won't take offense. My name is Bill Dwight. I've served on the council. If I succeed in this run, it'll be 16 years total. I served as ward counselor for Ward 1, and I am currently serving as a counselor at large. And I'm really grateful for the trust that's been invested in me by the community that I've asked to vote for me. And I'm also grateful for the trust invested in by my colleagues on the council who voted for me to serve as president, as Mark noted, we have a new charter that now has the council presiding over its own meeting without, once upon a time, was the mayor. And I've really enjoyed that. We seek out and live in cities and towns because they afford us the benefits of a community. Schools, emergency services, places to congregate and play, and the support of neighbors and neighborhoods. And Northampton has served that ideal as a place for most of its residents. And I made it my mission as a counselor and as a citizen to open that promise up to others who feel our home is out of reach, and just as importantly, preserve the dream for folks mostly retiring on fixed incomes so that they can stay here. And to that end, I will push to expand affordability, to increase and enhance the diversity that Northampton thrives on, and I will advocate for newly locally owned businesses and continue to work to develop a modern green infrastructure that facilitates new entrepreneurs. And I look forward to speaking to you more about these things as we banter here, or whatever it is that we're doing. I would appreciate your vote, of course, on November 3rd. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll move along to our first question. For the council to be successful, decisions must be made. You may see some similarity here to the first question to the school committee candidates. How do you see your role on the council, and what skills do you bring that will help balance your personal biases, your advocacy for the constituencies you represent, and the need for balanced governance? Do you have any conflicts of interest to disclose? And we will begin with Mr. Adams, then Mr. Dwight, and Mr. Warner.
I've been on the council for 6 years now, and I understand what it means to make tough decisions. I've done it many times. I've also stood up for things that I believe in, because I believe that when I did that, I was speaking for many people in the community, and I've stood up for things that didn't give me any political points, but I believe was in the best interest of the people that I represent in the community. Some of the skills that I bring, as I said earlier, I fight for my clients in the courtroom, and similarly, I fight for my constituents. I fight to make Northampton a better place for each and all of them. I'm a representative. The things I do are for the people I represent. I understand what that means, and I think that the city, having reelected me several times, and hopefully again, I think that they also believe that I act in their best interest. With respect to conflicts of interest, I have no conflicts of interest to disclose. Conflicts of interest are typically things that arise on a case-by-case, you know, basis. For example, if there is a conflict, a counselor can recuse themselves from a vote. I have no conflicts of interest to disclose tonight. But again, I know what it means to make tough decisions, and I know what it means to stand up for the people that I represent.
Thank you. Mr. Dwight?
I have no conflicts of interest, at least that I'm aware of. But as to my strengths, I facilitate conflicting interests. My strengths, I think, tend towards being able to negotiate and navigate conflict to try and find resolution. Now, the thing with being a representative, of course, is you're just that. You can't represent every opinion. For every 29,000 residents here, there is a unique opinion. And you can't represent all those. What you do when you run for office, you present yourself and your ethics. And if my ethos corresponds with something that you find that resonates and you feel that I'm just, then I deserve your vote if I could have it. If not, I know the other way that goes. So I think, as far as advocacy, I think one of the things I do share, at least with the preponderance of the city, is a desire to maintain social justice, to create equity, to create fairness, at the same time to create opportunities for people so that they may also enjoy this community, and I'm deeply, deeply committed to that.
Thank you. Mr. Warner.
Okay, the role on the council, I will try to be informed, do my homework, understand the city challenges and ask the right questions. I think this is going to be particularly important at budget hearings. I watch those budget hearings and I see the councilors being fairly passive. I think it's appropriate to ask questions like, well, wait a minute, why are these costs reasonable? Should we look into this a little bit further? Constituencies, well, look, you know, this is Northampton. We're not Boston. We're not partisan particularly. We're not counselors for Firefighter Local 138. I don't think we are. But I think here also we're recognizing we have to act for the benefit of all people in Northampton, people who don't have a lot of income, people who are middle class and can't afford additional tax hikes, people who want more services. We have to recognize all of those needs and find the right balance for them. I don't have any conflict of interest, but frankly, you know, I guess I do feel I want to take the opportunity to point out what may be a conflict of Bill and Jesse. You guys voted last year for the health insurance for the city council. These are part-time elected officials, and the independent compensation committee said, no, you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't double your salary and take the health insurance. Other part-time elected officials are not doing that in other cities. But they did, and I think that was a conflict of interest, and I think it is something that will be a problem for us when we have to deal with labor negotiations with the other departments. They can look at us and say, wait a minute, was this fair? But no, I don't have any other conflicts of interest, and I will maintain my high level of integrity.
So that opens the door to a possible rebuttal. Mr. Adams, do you wish to rebut?
Yes. There certainly is no conflict of interest in the city council voting on raises. For one, we did not vote ourselves a raise. We voted for future councils to have a raise, and those have not been raised. The pay has not been raised in more than 25 years. It's also important to note that the city council did not add any health insurance benefit. It's also important to note that the challenger announced his candidacy after we voted in the raises for the future council.
That's not true.
Okay. Okay. Well, if you'll hold your applause. Mr. Dwight, do you wish to rebut?
A soft rebut. The conflict actually is built in. It's a poison pill, of course. The council presides over those fiduciary votes, and as such, the reason, and it's actually even more than 25 years, it's close to 40 years, and by the way, it wasn't doubled. The council was originally paid $5,000 per councilor, and it went to $9,000. But the fact is that it's a losing proposition, and it is the one vote that doesn't necessarily afford a conflict. It just creates the appearance of a conflict that's exploitable.
Okay. So we're going to move on to our next question. And Mr. Dwight will begin with you, then Mr. Warner and Mr. Adams. The City of Northampton Department of Public Works operates enterprise funds for water and sanitary sewer. These are financed exclusively by user fees. The DPW has just completed and released studies which outline major capital expenses for both funds. Do you support raising sewer and water fees if necessary to pay for these infrastructure needs? Mr. Dwight.
That is to be determined. And that is to be determined. And yes, if the fees are justified, yes, I'm prepared to support it. The infrastructure obviously is critical. And in fact, actually, this is new. The council didn't used to vote on sewer and or stormwater fees or water fees. We didn't vote on those. Those were in the left to the Board of Public Works, which was a non-elected board and unaccountable to the public. And now, for the first time, we are charged with overseeing those, and we are consequently responsible to the public. The mayor reversed it when the proposal was for another increase, because proportionally compared to other districts, we had incrementally higher rates that were not comparable to other surrounding communities, and we needed to find that out. I have yet to be exposed to any of the investigation. That will be strongly vetted as we go forward, and I suspect that will have enormous community interest. So both Councilor Adams and myself advocated very strongly for the right to preside over those rates. And here we are. We are prepared to be accountable for that.
Okay. Mr. Warner?
Yeah, this is one where you have to question what is the amount of money that has to be spent. A lot of times in my business as a transportation planning consultant, I've worked with agencies where they've gotten estimates from engineers, and there hasn't been things that were absolutely realistic. They weren't things that need to be done right away. And sometimes there were capital programs that were done for just the desire to actually go ahead and build the things. I think that this is one where let's look at that, make sure we're spending wisely. Look, let's not compromise the quality of our water system. Let's make sure we're not having sewer backups. Let's not raise money for each year more than what people can afford. We have $100 million, say the engineers, for the stormwater fund. But the city has chosen to only raise $2 million per year for the most immediate needs. I think that was a good compromise, not to go and find the money all at once, but to raise smaller increments that are affordable.
Thank you. Mr. Adams.
This year, we actually voted a moratorium on the raising of the water and sewer fees. And I was actually one of the people who was in favor of it for a year, certainly not indefinitely. And during that time, the purpose is to look at more fair ways of instituting water and sewer fees. For example, just looking if we can make it more progressive and looking to see if we can make it so that the people who are struggling can have some sort of relief if possible. Also, with respect to accountability, and Councilor Dwight touched on this slightly, we voted with the new charter to take on this new duty to approve water and sewer fees. Now, previously, the Board of Public Works did it, and they're not an elected body, but me, Councilor Dwight, and others who supported the council taking on that decision did so because we thought it was more fair to you, the voters, to be able to vote directly on those people who are making these decisions. So as a matter of accountability, I supported the council making that decision rather than the Board of Public Works. To answer the question specifically, yes, these fees are going to have to go up, and I would be disingenuous to suggest that we can figure out some way to do these projects without making fees go up. So yes, they will have to go up, and if we're elected at some point, I will likely have to vote for those increases.
Thank you. Our next question. It has been a year since the Northampton bid was disbanded. How has downtown fared financially, socially, and environmentally without it? Should anything change? We'll start with Mr. Warner, then Mr. Adams, Mr. Dwight.
The BID is the Business Improvement District, and you know, it had a sudden demise there that was a great surprise to the city government and I think to a lot of the business leaders in town too, but it its roles were primarily helping with the holiday lights, providing some marketing for the city. And I think in those regard, the city has picked up some of the slack in taking care of those. It's not clear whether they'd be able to do that again. I think there has been some changes. I'm not sure it's related to the demise of the BID. I think there has been an increase in panhandling in downtown, and I think this is something that the city should look at more carefully about what it can do. I think the Vibrant Sidewalks resolution sort of set the completely wrong tone on that one. It's not suggesting that that should just be embraced. But I think where there may be an opportunity to go and replace the BID, it might be done with incremental parking fees. Right now, a parking study was done recently that did recommend increasing the amount of parking fees for downtown and increasing the application of those fees past 6 p.m. This is money that could be used to go and increase parking facilities in downtown to help with the city, and could also be partly used in a dedicated fund purely for the downtown. So that's something that could make up for some of the loss of the BID should that system not be put back in place.
Thank you. Where am I? Mr. Adams.
Since the BID was found to be illegal, downtown seems to have some more empty storefronts. Of course, Faces went out and then fortunately was saved, and then there's Iris Photo, Spoleto still empty. And I don't know if that can be attributed to the Business Improvement District going away, but it's extremely important to support downtown. I think the Pulaski Park renovation is key to supporting downtown. I think the passenger train will help bring people downtown. And downtown is important to the entire community. I have my business down there. My father's had a business down there for almost 40 years. I lived on Main Street for 15 years. And throughout the years, I have seen more panhandlers. And I think what we need to do is help them provide, you know, lead them to services so that they can help themselves. But with respect specifically to the question, it's tough to gauge exactly what effect the Business Improvement District, the loss of it, has had. But it's important to try to make up for some of those services. There's an organization of stakeholders who has gotten together since the BID was found to be illegal, and they are supposed to at some point present some sort of a proposal to make up for some of the services lost. And I myself, trying to do what I can, rejoin the Chamber of Commerce. I was a member previously, and I'm a member of the Northampton Young Professionals. So the business community in downtown is extremely important, and I'm committed to looking ways to enhance it.
Thank you. Mr. Dwight.
Well, the BID never existed, according to a judge, so it's a moot point in some respect. But the fact that the BID, what the people in the BID did was provide more than just holiday lights and the like. They swept and kept up downtown. They shoveled the sidewalks and made it accessible for folks. And actually, they incurred the responsibility that should be held by the commercial property owners, the same as you or I, we have to shovel our sidewalks and sweep our sidewalks. It's a standing ordinance. It's part of a civic engagement. To Mr. Warner's point, the parking fees actually do go into parking and maintaining and enhancing the parking system. So that's precisely what those are for, and plus they pay for some police cruisers too. I was recently taken to task on this issue, but the fact that we have, what I'm actually trying to encourage is greater civic involvement beyond just the citizens, and beyond to discuss issues that aren't, that we have a number of threats to businesses, not the least of which is online purchasing, which is competitive, but also really onerous rents. We have some of the highest rents in the state for commercial properties for the business owners who are struggling under the thinnest of margins. And the fact is that conversation hasn't been had. We've talked about panhandlers as being some kind of a deterrent. It's nothing comparable to the pressures that a business owner experiences from those high rents. So that environment is dictated mostly by those commercial property owners, and I hope we get to expand that conversation.
Thank you. We'll move on to our next question. Do you support Northampton moving toward greater energy self-sufficiency? If so, where do you see opportunities and how do we get there? And we'll start with Mr. Adams.
I certainly support Northampton moving towards greater self-sufficiency. Here's how we can do that, and here's how we have begun to do that. For one, there's a sustainability rating. It's a star rating system. We received a 5-star sustainability rating, and we were one of 3 communities when we received that designation to get that. Some other things are we've created a climate adaptation plan, and there's some that's begun, so we're going to prepare ourselves to deal with climate change in the future. Some things that I think are extremely important to self-sufficiency is the solar facility that's going to be built where the former landfill was. This is going to be a win for both the taxpayer and the environment. It's going to be clean energy. This is going to create 45% of the city's municipal energy. It's going to save $9 million over 20 years for the taxpayer. I am, have been, and always will be a supporter of solar energy. When this vote was first taken, it was controversial. Now, in retrospect, it seems like a no-brainer. I was one of the people who supported it, even when it was controversial. Another thing is the plastic bag ban ordinance that I wrote and presented and passed unanimously. A third thing, or an additional thing, I've co-sponsored a tree ordinance, which is going to protect our public shade trees and increase the inventory.
Thank you, Mr. Dwight.
Well, I'm next. Okay. Northampton actually, as Councilor Adams mentioned, actually we were the first in the country to receive a 5-star rating. We stand as a paragon actually in the country. People come here to study us because actually Northampton has been committed for a long time. People, not just myself, but any number of people, it's part of the warp and weave of Northampton's municipal government. I've been on the Energy and Sustainability Committee for 4-5 years at this point. And the fact that we have such a committee that works to create and foster more conservation than any other community in the state, we outsold everyone on solar acquisitions in the state. We have a community that's already expressed a strong desire to reduce their carbon footprint, to be prepared for climate change, and to be responsible to and among themselves for reducing their commitment to their cost associated with increased energy expenses. The solar array actually is going to account for, I think it was, maybe 40% more of all the municipal buildings, all their energy costs, all the buildings that we subsidize currently. We don't look at that as an end. That is actually just part of the progress that we plan to go far beyond.
Yeah, of course you want to support greater energy self-sufficiency, good for Northampton, good for the climate, but it's also an issue, too, of making sure that it's something that works affordably for the city. One thing that these guys didn't mention is the LED streetlights initiative, too, which is a great energy saver and is an initiative that will pay for itself back very quickly. That is something the city is going ahead with. But I am a little concerned about the solar array. This isn't an issue about the principles of solar energy. Of course you want to do that. But right now this project is only viable if the state lifts the cap on selling that energy back to National Grid. And you also have the tax exemptions that the federal and state are providing to the company that would be building it. If this doesn't go through, this project cannot go through either. And the city should make sure that it doesn't go and put itself into an obligation where it is obliged for the next 20 years to buy the energy produced by Ameresco without being able to sell it back to the grid or use it itself. So that's an issue where you have a goal that is laudable, but it could be a luxury that we can't afford, and I would not want Northampton to take on a long-term obligation despite the energy benefits.
I don't know if I qualify for a rebuttal, but there's
no.
A correction.
Okay.
Correction is, it's simply to say that Mr. Warner is absolutely right, and in fact, actually, this contract won't make any sense if the net metering cap is not lifted. The fact is that built into this contract is an escape clause with that distinct possibility being there. If it does not, the cap is not lifted, the project does not go forward.
Okay. Thank you for that clarification. We'll move on to our next question. This one will begin with Mr. Dwight, then Mr. Warner, Mr. Adams. What are the pros and cons of the payment in lieu of taxes or pilot initiative? Mr. Dwight.
The pros are somewhat self-evident. I mean, again, this goes to the issue of trying to increase civic engagement and participation. Now, historically, what's happened, and part of the pressures that we've experienced from the previous debate and that we're going to hear from this debate, is the fact that the state has moved away from progressive taxation, which taxes people's income or corporations, and they've moved towards creating greater responsibility on a very regressive tax system, which is property taxes, which is the ones we feel every day, the ones that Mr. Warner was citing, the ones that Councilor Adams was citing. These are our pressures. And the fact is that as that burden becomes ever increasing, and it will continue to increase, it's appropriate to ask, and we can only ask. We do not have the authority to demand or bully or cajole, as some have implied, but to simply ask, hat in hand, if we can get some of the nonprofits to help participate in the payments of emergency services, to help subsidize the things, the infrastructure that supports them that's not fee subsidized. And that's a good thing. It expands the conversation and increases their involvement. The downside is demonizing people and demonizing the nonprofits who actually do serve the city very well. We have a synergistic relationship with them, and I don't want that hurt in the least.
Thank you. Mr. Warner?
Yeah, and these are the issues. I think the key pro about it is that the city has structured, or the mayor has structured, the initiative to reflect the cost that is not the full range of services that the city incurs, but rather the ones that represent things that each of these agencies, organizations that would otherwise be tax exempt, that are tax exempt, would have to pay. These are things like the use of the roads, the use of emergency services. These are things they are benefiting from, but they are not making contribution. And in this regard, I think it is reasonable to ask. I think it is appropriate that Northampton is not in the forefront of doing this. So it's 25% of what they would otherwise pay. And when you look at Smith College, which is $450 million of taxable property and charging $50,000 for tuition, you really have to wonder, look, is this purely the charitable entity that was set up, 100 years ago? My wife is a Smith graduate. I don't want to go and totally undermine it, though, of course. But the other issue, too, is that there are also things that the agencies can do, that these organizations, there are about a dozen of them. There is $1 million threshold, so it's not the smaller agencies. It doesn't apply to churches. It doesn't apply to cemeteries. It's those things that have over $1 million in assets and property assets, and these are things where they can also work down up to 50% of that through services to the city. So where Smith does provide classes for high school students, this is not something that they'd be able to go and take that back, and I think that's appropriate too.
Thank you. Mr. Adams.
I support the pilot program. All the points were mentioned already. One thing I will point out is that 22% of Northampton property is exempt from taxes, and that's an outstanding amount. So I think it is fair to go and ask for these voluntary contributions. The cons are, people have to pay, whereas they didn't have to pay before, and I don't necessarily think that all these nonprofits are completely flush with cash, but we're hoping that, being that it's only 25% of what they would have paid if there were no exemption, hopefully they can swing it. A con is that they can say no, flat out, and at this point we have no way of forcing them to do it. The credit system is, a con from the revenue raising standpoint. The point is to create revenue, and if this could raise up to $1.78 million in revenue, and if everyone got their 50% credit after applying, then we'd only have $900,000. So from that standpoint, that's a con. I think that the largest institutions should be included in this. There's an exemption for religious institutions, and I think that if they otherwise qualify, I don't think it's fair that they should be exempt simply because they're a religious institution. But there's more to be discussed. There's a big community discussion going on about this right now. I support it, and hopefully we'll have a really good plan in place at the end of it that the request for the entities to take part will be abided by.
Thank you. We'll move on to our last question. Again, we will follow this with a couple of questions from you who are sitting out there. And we'll begin with Mr. Warner, then Mr. Adams, and Mr. Dwight. What do you see are the pressing issues that the council should address and resolve in the coming year?
I'm not sure if there are any labor negotiations that are coming up in 2016, but if they are, those are obviously going to be key ones. The city, the mayor does negotiate these, but there is a role for the city council. And that is set up under the laws of Proposition 2.5. It says that the state can otherwise, that the council then has the final say, they can reject it. In 2013, the council did that when they decided that the arbitration award that the firefighters got was not affordable to the city. So I think that is a role. If it comes up here, I hope that the council will take that seriously and do what they feel is truly best for the people, all the people in Northampton. I do know that cable TV is one that will, the contract there is one that comes up in 2016, that there may be some opportunities here to ensure that there may be some better deals that we can get with faster broadband for businesses downtown. I do think that this issue with the health insurance is still one that maybe we should look at again. I mean, the real issue here was that this was an independent commission. It was set up by the charter to say what should be the compensation for elected officials. This was a fine group of people, and they did their work independently, and they wrote a report that any consultant would be proud of. And they came to a conclusion that was different from what the 9 members of the council felt they wanted themselves. It was for the future, of course, but I think it is still something that should be looked at again. Maybe 2016 is the right year for that.
Thank you. Mr. Adams.
I think there are a few things of immediate concern. Opiate addiction, people are dying in our community from heroin overdoses and opiate abuse. I think that we need to look at that immediately. The community has started. There's an opiate task force, which isn't specifically municipal, but it certainly involves Northampton. And for that we need prevention, education, and treatment. But I think opiate usage is an immediate problem that we have to deal with ASAP. Affordability, it's a large problem and it's a long-term problem, but it's something that we need to, I think we are thinking about and we need to continue thinking about, and that needs to start immediately. Unfunded pension liability. Going forward, the taxpayers in the future are going to be on the hook for a tremendous amount of unfunded pension liability. We actually have started a trust fund to deal with that. We're one of the forward-thinking communities out there that recognize this problem and have taken that measure to create that trust fund. Right now there's only a small amount in there, but the goal is to build that up and tackle that issue. And deferred road maintenance, that's another major issue that we need to tackle immediately, because things like deferred road maintenance only get more expensive the longer they are put off.
Thank you. So we'll turn now. I'm sorry, Mr. Dwight.
No, sorry. I do talk a lot, so it's actually, the challenge is actually maybe even less granular and more meta, if you will. We have a retail economy that's in jeopardy, largely due to the fact, as I said, the pressures that I described before, online purchasing, really excessively high rents for downtown businesses. We have little opportunity for people 40 and under who are burdened with college debt to try and find enough money or a bank willing to loan them the money to even start a home here in the community. On the other end, we have seniors on fixed incomes who are feeling compelled to move out because they can't sustain living here. And as such, we are a very middle-class community, and we will be just that. And we will lose what diversity we have. And I think our objective should be to expand that diversity. Cultural, economic, gender, it covers the spectrum of humanity. And we thrive when we are different and we're better. When we have these conflicting visions, they actually strengthen the community. Complacency is my biggest dread here. So to that end, I'm going to continue to work to establish more affordable residences and opportunities and to also expand through a municipal Wi-Fi system that would improve the infrastructure to allow businesses to grow and flourish here, new businesses, and give everyone an opportunity to expand that choice. Thanks.
Okay.
Sorry.
Thank you. I think all three of you have now spoken on that question. Yes? Good. Yes. Thank you. Now we will turn to audience questions.
Madam Moderator, this is 60-second answers. Speed round?
No, what I did before was we took the questions from the audience, then you do your closing statements.
No, no, he's asking how long we have.
60 seconds, rather than 90.
Oh, I'm sorry, 1 minute, yes. Sorry, okay. So, if you'll come forward again, identify yourself, and ask your question.
Yes, my name is Marjorie Hess. I live downtown on Masonic Street, and I'm a trustee at Forbes Library. And I do find it necessary to say I'm really sorry the trustee candidates were not included in tonight's very excellent forum. My question for the city council candidates, though. Unfortunately, in recent years, Forbes Library has needed to cut services and hours because of funding shortfalls. What can you, as a city councilor, do to ensure adequate funding for Forbes Library?
Okay. You all understand the question? And we'll begin with Mr. Adams, then Mr. Dwight, Mr. Warner. Go ahead.
Well, as you know, I'm a former Forbes Library trustee, and I worked with you, and I think nobody in this race understands that as well as I do. Forbes Library is a very important institution, and it's one of many important, and the library services are one of the many most vital important services that we provide. The issue with funding Forbes Library adequately is the same issue with funding the schools and funding police and fire and everything else that's important. Declining state aid and throughout the years, and we have had to find different ways of making up for that. That's why I'm hopeful about this pilot program, for example, because we're finding new revenues to try to save those services and to try to relieve the taxpayers as well, but also to try to save services like the Forbes Library services that you referenced.
Thank you. Mr. Dwight?
You know, Marjorie, as Councilor Adams framed it, of course, there's competing interests for every dollar, and each one comes up short every time. And actually, that's one of the hardest parts of being a councilor is not pander by promising the sun, the moon, stars, and unicorns grazing on every lawn, but the fact that we are faced with ever diminishing revenues from the state. And then the burden, as I said earlier, goes back on to the property owners. And, you know, I think as we've continued, and I am a strong advocate for the library, and I think that it's an almost underappreciated asset to the community because it actually serves people who don't have access in the main. And I think as a social justice institution, it is critical to preserve. And I mean, that's all I can say. I can't give you a dollar amount or what it is that we can be prepared to do. But I want you to know that in my heart of hearts, that I truly believe that is a great institution.
Yeah, I understand Bill's comment as well. It is competing interests. I know the state does set a minimum amount of money that a community has to spend on its library. And that's where we're at in Northampton. The libraries have been a big loser in the city budget over the last 10 years. You know, but I'm happy to be a patron of both Lilly Library and Forbes Library. My wife and is probably one of the biggest circulators in the system here, especially in the children's room. But I don't know if there's anything more that the city can do. If you want to make sure that the money is available where it's most needed, it can be something where this council can decide, look, we have to do more than that. But right now, it's at the minimum. I'm glad we're not shirking our responsibilities and say, you want a better library, you know, drive to Amherst or Hadley. So I think we do have to do that. It is providing a service. I'm glad there's a second library up in Florence at Lilly Library, and I hope that you do the best with what they have.
Thank you. Next question, if you'll come forward. And please identify yourself.
So my name is Jasper Lapienski. I live at 43 West Street. Ironically, my question is also about access to the library, but the question is going to be framed a little bit differently. There is only one way to get from downtown to the library on foot. That same piece of sidewalk is also the primary route from downtown to Smith College. The pavement on that sidewalk is corroded in many places down to the rebar, so that, and I'll hold my hand up for the audience to see, the rebar is sticking up about that much. My question is very simple. Is that the best we can do? And please, in your answer, spare me any comments about limited resources. That's been gone over enough. It would take $50 to patch that hole.
Okay. We'll start with Mr. Dwight, then Mr. Warner, Mr. Adams.
Wow, you just took the wind right out of my sails, Jasper. It was sort of nice. As you know, essentially, we have a question of authority versus influence, and we have influence in this respect, and we do not have the authority to dictate where holes get patched by the DPW. You've mentioned this before in public comment. I'm actually sorry to hear that it's still status quo. I agree with you. I don't know about your assessment on how much it will cost to repair it, but that really shouldn't matter. It is actually when you have, as you described, exposed rebar like that, that needs to be addressed. That's actually not only a hazard, but it's a liability if you're even thinking about it more fiscally conscientiously. So I don't know what more to say about that.
Thank you, Mr. Warner.
Yeah, Bill's right. This is something where the council does not run the city departments. It's up to the mayor and the department heads to go and choose how that's done. That said, sidewalks are obviously part of the infrastructure here, and within the downtown, you want to make sure that you have walkability, especially to agencies, organizations, or destinations like Forbes Library. So I would hope that the city would respond to that, and in general, that they would look to see what are the paths that people use the most and use that as a priority to make sure that that's where the fixes go. But I'm not sure that again, this is really a decision for the council, except in the broad framework in budget hearings to go and try and influence the mayor to recognize the needs of sidewalks as a priority for the city.
Thank you. Mr. Adams.
Mr. Lapiansky, I've actually worked with you on sidewalk access issues, like back when the Public Works and City Council Conference Committee was in existence. And what we did was work, and I think, created a better policy for reporting the obstruction of sidewalks. And I'm concerned that, you know, maybe that hasn't influenced the response time. But in a city that's touting itself as walkable, I do agree that that's a problem. I typically find the DPW to be pretty responsive. Unfortunately, it sounds like there's an exception here. I'm certainly willing to put in a request for a work order tomorrow.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on now to our closings. Well, is there just one more?
With all due respect, we have enough time in this city for all the questions.
Okay. Come forward.
Hi, Wes Hardy. I just had a question. I was reading in the campaign materials that there was some number of millions, I forget what it was, that was going to be spent on a some sort of underpass for bicycles and to go around a train or something, and I was just wondering what the different prospective council members thought about that project or their ideas on it. Also, thank you for allowing me to ask a question.
You're welcome. We'll start with Mr. Warner.
Sure, okay, this was not a plant. I can respond to that one. This is something, when I served on the Passenger Rail Committee, Tim Doherty from the State Department of Transportation mentioned that it was going to build this underpass. And then when he said it was $2.25 million, I said, wait, you're building an underpass? Who specified an underpass this location? And why would a culvert cost $2.25 million under 40 feet of track? You know, that's seven times the cost of a city house. But this is not a city expenditure, this is a state expenditure. But it's being done at the request of the city. And I think that years ago when the city put this in its planning documents, I don't think they fully considered what the cost would be. Look, this is not, again, a city expenditure, but we are still state taxpayers too. And I just want to make sure that all of our public funds be used properly. So I would hope that the city might suggest that let's use that money, keep it in bicycle infrastructure, but extend the trail out to Haydenville or other services that are a better use of the funds.
Mr. Adams?
I have a strong disagreement with the challenger. That project is important, and the project money is a gift from the state.
It's a gift that can only be used for that project, and it's an important project. We cannot tell them we're going to take the money and use it for other projects, even other transportation projects, even other bike path projects. If we don't take that money, we don't get that money, and some other community will, probably one that won't benefit Northampton people whatsoever. How many times tonight have we heard that there's declining state revenue? We would be foolish to turn down $2.25 million to build an important bike underpass in our own community.
Mr. Dwight.
When Mr. Warner refers to that as being discussed some years ago, it was 10 years ago, it was actually a very, very public process that engaged the community. The request for the tunnel was a key point of that. The thing is that actually, even if we did reject the money for this and said, no, we think this is foolish, and why would you invest in this? We would prefer a different crossing system. Amtrak has already said, it's actually rendered this moot, that you can't do an at-grade crossing. That an at-grade crossing is unacceptable for them, and they won't allow it. So that would be the terminus point for the bike trail. I think to Mr. Adams' point and Mr. Warner's point, both of the fact that this is from the state, and it is the rare gift, if you will, from the state. And at this point, that issue has been vetted, and it will actually serve a constructive and useful purpose and create greater safety for people on the bike trail.
Okay, thank you. Now we'll move on to closing statements. They are 1 minute each, and we will start with Mr. Adams, then Mr. Dwight, and then Mr. Warner.
I'd like to thank the sponsors and candidates for this robust discussion and all of you here tonight for coming out and hearing us out. I've worked hard in my 8 years in public office, and if reelected, I will continue to fight for environmental justice, fairness, accessibility, and accountability in city government and a community in which we can all afford to live. Please give me one of your two votes for city councilor at large on Tuesday, November 3rd. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dwight.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask you to assess my work to date and assess me as the person you know me to be. And then I hope that I've earned your vote by that. But more importantly, this election actually is not a high volume election. We're going to have a pretty low turnout. And that is enormously discouraging. Whoever wins this doesn't get to walk out and say they have a mandate, or that they can even say they speak for the majority of the people in the city. Anyone, I mean, if you can impress, the fact that you're here shows that you're committed, but the fact that if you know anyone, that you can impress upon them the crucial aspect of investing a vote in this election, please do, because we'll have lots and lots of people turn out for Bernie Sanders who we aren't even going to be talking about for months. I want you to turn out here for this is where the rubber meets the road. This is the election that actually affects your lives more importantly and more critically than any presidential election you could vote in. So please encourage everyone to get out and vote. November 3rd, I'd like one of those votes, please.
And Mr. Warner.
Okay. Thanks, this was fun. I hope you will take a look at our flyer. Those of you who are here in the hall, I'll be offering some outside there. And you can also look at the website, warnerforcouncil.com. You'll find more information about the issues we've discussed today, my biography, my specific stands on many of these issues, and look at the dozen of recent op-eds and letters to the editor that I've had over the years that deal with these issues and that show my values. I think you will find there, and what I've tried to convey tonight, that I am a sensible candidate, that I do recognize the issues that the city faces that are important, that I do recognize that while we care for social justice, that the greatest thing we can do for social justice is make sure we run our city efficiently and that we don't price people out through our taxes and fees. You will also see that my background is consistent with the ideals of a citizen legislature, and I think my views and values are consistent with most of yours. You know, I promise you integrity and conscientiousness, civility, maturity, and good sense to deal with focus on real city issues. Thanks.
Thank you to our candidates. Let's give them a hand.
We have to stay here.
I just want to again thank our sponsors and our organizers. So thank you again to the Northampton League, and especially to Becky Shannon, who did a wonderful job organizing this.
Bravo.
I want to thank the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association, the Leeds Civic Association, and Penny Geis for being our timer. That was essential.
Thank you.
Thank you. NCTV and WHMP. We have a little time in the room. The candidates will stay around for additional questions. And you can, again, pass your questions to WHMP and NCTV, and they'll try to get them to the candidates. Thank you again for attending tonight.